识自通，出身工人家庭对拉尔夫劳伦有何影响？
And your values and your sense of self or your insecurities, they all come from the exposure to your parents and your involvement.
时尚风潮瞬息万变，在日益多元化的产业里，他如何吸引眼球，抢占市场？
Being a fashion designer, a promising career plan.
They were not just a business to me. They were my voice to myself.
他又如何成为上流生活方式与美国梦的最成功代言者？
It seems that you are presenting real people, not just the models.
I was never about fashion. I was about living.
杨澜专访美国著名时装设计师拉尔夫·劳伦，畅聊他打造上百亿美元时尚帝国背后的故事。敬请收看。
大家好，欢迎收看杨澜访谈录。最近呢，网络有一句流行语，人一定要有梦想，万一实现了呢？这话用在著名的时尚设计师 Ralph Lauren 先生的身上再合适不过了。他的人生呢，充满了传奇。举目望去，全球最著名的时尚设计师当中，如果有谁最能够代表美国式的生活方式，那一定是非他莫属。他的人生充满传奇，出身于工人阶级的家庭，却在高中时代就梦想着成为百万富翁。非科班出身的设计师，却一手打造了横跨全球的时尚帝国。他既是时尚界的追梦人，又是时尚界的造梦人。在他长达几十年的成功背后，究竟有着怎样的商业逻辑和人生轨迹呢？我在纽约采访了他。
1939年10月14日，出生于美国的拉尔夫·劳伦是纽约城中一个犹太移民家庭中最小的儿子。他的父亲是一位油漆工人，母亲则是标准的家庭主妇。每当下课放学，所有的小孩都是出去玩乐嬉戏，拉尔夫·劳伦却是不停打工，同时不断培养自己对服装的兴趣。
Ms. Lauren, thank you very much. But first of all, tell me what home meant for you when you grew up at Bronx in New York City as a family of immigrants.
Well, home was good. Actually, a lot of people, the Bronx is the city, the borough that I grew up in Manhattan, in New York. And that was, a unique place because it was sort of New York as you might not see it today, but as you really get a sense of the flavor of people living. A lot of immigrants came over from Russia, and they came from Italy, and they came from Ireland, and so there's a mixed section of all kinds of people. An area that would be considered tough by some kids, you know, I'd say, well, that's a rough area, you know, did you get beat up when you went to school? I was not that big, but I was strong. It made you strong. But basically, I loved it because I got a chance to really have a lot of friends. But it was a tough life growing up.
But you had, as the youngest of four children in the house, I believe you had most of your clothes as hand-me-downs, right?
What were
some of the piece of clothes that you really desperately needed or wanted?
You know, when you're the youngest, you're always looking up to your brothers, you know, and your sister. But the brothers played ball, and they were, every time I went into school, they were there first, and so I had to prove myself. So, you know, I always wanted certain things that my brothers had. You know, could I get that sweater? I'd have to steal a sweater from my brothers. I grew up actually being the youngest. I was very well taken care of. I was the baby in the family, and my mother would say, take care of him. So they called me the baby, and I sort of got the luxury of life. And so I didn't steal it. They gave me things.
But what represented your own identity when you grew up?
When I grew up, in terms of at that age, what I don't know if I had an identity, but I remember years ago, I don't know why, there was a pair of suede shoes in a store, blue suede shoes. And it was before Elvis Presley had a song called Blue Suede Shoes. But I would pass, on my way to school, I would pass a store that had these suede shoes, and I said, I gotta have those shoes, how am I gonna get them? And every day after school, I'd pass these shoes. And it was ironic because I was not only thinking of clothes, I was really, you know, going out with girls. I was trying to look good, see what was sharp. Mm-hmm. And
did you finally get that pair of shoes?
I don't think so. But I made them. What happened is later, I think they were inspirations. You know, I think when you're younger, you have visions of what your life could be. And I said earlier that movies and books open the world for you. And so maybe those shoes represented something to me. Mm-hmm. I don't know at the time. They just looked great. Mm-hmm. Years later, I think I love shoes. And I've been able to, I think, on some levels, growing up was the platform of things that I wanted as I got older. And so instead of looking at a store, I'd say, I want to make those shoes, but I can make them better. Mm. So on some levels, I had a very good childhood, and I had the clothes, and some levels, hand-me-downs. Mm. But as I grew up, I was inspired to see if I could do things that were better.
在劳伦看来，父亲弗兰克也是个艺术家，他会弹曼陀林、钢琴和小提琴，还自学了装饰，在墙上甚至是教堂里画壁画，站在高高的梯子上涂画天花板。劳伦至今仍然记得父亲带他去大都会博物馆里参观绘画珍品的情景。受到这些作品启发的父亲会仿制一些绘画，并且无师自通地学会在画上制造大理石和木纹的效果。
In all sorts of product lines you have designed, I noticed there's a line of paints.
Yes.
And I knew that your father,
yes,
being an artist, had to, you know, make extra income by painting other people's houses.
Yes.
And how was that linked to you?
Well, I was approached by a painting company, and I started to think about paints. I said, well, why can't I do paints? My father was an artist and he's a painter. I know about color. Mm-hmm. And I also know what is not around that I think I could do. So my vision of paints was just not just painting it white or blue or the mm-hmm. color of the house. As time went on, I started to see homes and old European homes and they had great cracks in the walls. Mm-hmm. In the Bronx, a crack in the wall didn't look very good. Mm-hmm. But in Italy, it represented age and years and history. So sometimes people want history overnight. They don't want to wait 150 years.
But in retrospect, I was asking this question about your father.
Yes.
Was to see how your parents dealt with the toughness of life at that time. Did you remember them as being very bitter about the situation they found themselves in?
No, I think my parents were very, honestly, very nice people. They were not, they were happy to be in this country. Mm-hmm. They loved their life and they loved their children. So I grew up with a very warm family, not a family that wanted to run away. Mm. It's a family that enjoyed it. And later on, those things come back to as you have your own family. And I always believe the parents are the backbone of children. Mm. You know, what you get at home, even though you don't know it, it's all coming through you. And your values and your sense of self or your insecurities, they all come from the exposure to your parents and your involvement.
并非时装设计科班出身的拉尔夫·劳伦，踏入时尚领域的第一个工作是波士顿地区的一个领带销售员。当时的领带花色都是千篇一律的深黑，了无新意。一次偶然的机会，他争取到了设计领带的机会。他大刀阔斧地为领带的外形做出革新，不仅在宽度上加大了两倍，色泽也更为鲜艳多彩。宽领带系列出乎意料的大卖，引领起当时的流行风潮。1967年，拉尔夫·劳伦建立了时装公司，正式开启时尚大业。
But when you first started in late 60s, was, you know,being a fashion designer a promising career plan?
I never knew what a fashion designer was. Mm. I never heard the word. I never thought about it. It was only personal to me as to what I want to do with how I can look good and go walk into a store. Mm. But what I did notice is that as I grew up, a lot of people would ask me, where'd you get that? I love what you're wearing. Mm. Calvin Klein, who's a great designer, grew up two blocks away, and he remembered me, and he said, I remember Ralph. He used to wear a safari jacket all the time. So even at that age, I was interested in style. Mm-hmm. I was interested in looking cool, never thinking that I knew how to make it, or never the involvement with product and involvement with design was not part of what it was. It was just my eye saying, I think I want this. That carried through in my life, not knowing it.
Well, tell us about your first breakthrough.
Well,
I know it's about the ties that you sewed a lot of them during the first year.
My first real breakthrough was I had worked for a tie company in England. I lived in America, but they were a company that represented some English fabrics, and they sold some good stores. And I was 24 years old. I was looking for a job, and someone recommended this company that made ties, and they sold some other stores. So I met the owners, and they said, we're looking for someone to be in New York, represent our New York office. So I watched, I was there only to sell products, not to show some people in. And basically what happened is as I was watching, I would say to the older gentlemen and the executives in the company, why don't we do this? Can we do this? And they sort of looked at each other, and the boss said, the world is not ready for Ralph Lauren. So they were sort of saying, Ralph, keep it quiet and stay in your corner. You're 24 years old. And what happened is I started to see my ideas that I would say to my bosses. Can we make that tie? Can we make the wide tie? And they said, Ralph, it's not in our world. This is not the place, you know. The world isn't ready for you. And so I met another gentleman who heard about me, and I said I would love to do a tie line. And I did the tie line, and he hired me, gave me a drawer in the Empire State.
What do you mean, drawer?
If you walk into a sales office, there was a little drawer on the bottom of all the bureaus that you're looking at. All the people have showrooms, they have all their things around the showroom. Well, they gave me a little drawer at the bottom. And I had one drawer where I put my samples of ties that I made, which were wider ties. And so they all laughed, these other companies, and saying, what's this? Anyway, what happened is that I started to design the ties where the America was started to look about to European fashion. They started to wake up. There was an interest all of a sudden in men's things. Before it was only women's. All of a sudden men were talking about clothing that fit slimmer.
According to my information, you sewed $500,000 worth of ties within the first year. How many ties you have to make yourself? You didn't have any help.
I didn't
but
have
yourself,
any help.
Right?
I didn't have any help. I actually had my father-in-law and mother-in-law and my wife helped sew on labels with ties one Christmas. When I went to Bloomingdale's, the buyer said, we like your ties, Ralph, but would you make them narrower? And would you, we don't want to use your label, we want to use our own label, but we'll give you a really good order. Now here I was, no business, and hungry, and I said to the buyer, I said, my heart's in my throat, or whatever the expression is, I would love to sell Bloomingdale's. They were the hottest store, and young, hot store. I said, but I can't sell you. I'm closing my bag, and I'm not going to sell you. Yeah. 6 months later, they called me back.
Wow.
And they said, Ralph, we can't find your ties anywhere, and we want to buy them, and we want to put a rack in, a rack of ties amongst the other ties. And that was it. Mm. The breakthrough was they bought it. The breakthrough for me is that I learned to trust my instincts. I learned to trust my own sense. Because the normal thing to do is say, I'll make it any way you want to. I mean, that's how the world was. I want to sell you the ties, you know, maybe I'll have a new fashion for you next year. Let me buy it. My philosophy was that I love these ties. I made them. They were not just a business to me. They were my voice to myself.
宽领带取得的巨大成功只是拉尔夫劳伦迈出的第一步。在这之后，他正式成为了一名为男装界带来革命性变化的男装设计师。他的设计专注于融合了西部拓荒、印第安文化、昔日好莱坞情怀的美国风格，被认为是美国经典的最佳代表。著名女主持人奥普拉·温弗瑞对这个举世闻名的设计师有过这样的描述：拉夫尔·劳伦卖的不只是衣服而已，他卖的是一种人人向往的生活，他把那种生活以平易近人的方式呈现给每一个美国人，让人们觉得梦想并非遥不可及。
You know, the 60s and early 70s were quite chaotic here with all sorts of social movements, and then you have the Vietnam War and, you know, assassination of JFK and all sorts of things happening. Young people are rebelling. Their parents on those more conservative attitudes towards life. What was the message in your design as a response to that age?
Well, number one, it's an interesting thing because the age had, you know, the hippie, and they had all kinds of things going through Vietnam, the hippie movements. And my things were for the young people because I was young and I saw what young people wanted. But the world is never the way you think it is. Just because it's the 60s doesn't mean everyone ran around as hippies. Doesn't mean that everyone was going to Vietnam. The world went on, and jobs were jobs, and people were still making products, and young men and women were not all growing beards and walking around with tank tops. They were seriously working hard. So what I hit at that time was the new American, the issue about how to have a world and how to make a career and how to build and how to express yourself in an individual way. You didn't have to, you know, sing all the songs or be a rock and roller to care about those things. So I lived amongst that. I was part of it. I recognized it. I loved John Kennedy. I loved America. I was not revolting, but I also saw that the world needed change and young people were still working and they still wanted individuality. So it was a very interesting time for me. And the stores were receptive. Maybe if it was 5 years earlier, they wouldn't have been receptive. My timing, I guess, has been my instinct.
But you were digging even further into the heart of American heritage and history to find something more unique about the characteristic of being America, right?
Well, I was loving America, and I was learning about America myself because I didn't grow up all over the place. And you start to see the American cowboy, you see the American who lives in the Adirondacks, you see the West, you see John Kennedy and Hyannis. There were so many inspirations coming at you in the world, and the world was changing.
70年代初，拉尔夫·劳伦首度推出了他的女装系列，很重要的原因之一是受到妻子的影响。他说：“我的妻子有着极好的穿衣风格，不去盲目的追求时尚，浑身上下散发着自己独特的风格。”正因如此，我希望为这样的女人设计衣服。从此，拉尔夫·劳伦对女性时装的影响力与日俱增。他将男装的剪裁手法运用到了女装的设计中，推出了简约舒适的女士衬衫，以其高雅自然的设计风格征服了美国女性，深受好评。
I want you to elaborate a little bit about your trips to the West, because the very much Ralph Lauren look, or the polo look, represents something authentic and original from America, not something from Europe. How did you find that?
That was just natural. One of the interesting things that happened is when I was making my first women's clothes, I made some suits. Not having all that knowledge about what was going on in fashion and women's wear or what was happening in Europe, I made Glen Platt suits. I made some real menswear because my first inspiration was to take the things I was doing for men's, doing it for women. And the women at that time, you know, was wearing skirts, and I loved tailored jackets. And from the movies or from the books, I started to see a lot of the stars in the past, the Hollywood. So Hollywood was also very inspirational. And so when you look at the movies, you see Greta Garbo or Marlene Dietrich or Audrey Hepburn, or you start to see stylish attitudes.
And women were becoming stronger.
They were
at that time.
Yes, and Katharine Hepburn was a very big inspiration because she was very much a natural, free sensibility. She wore her pants. Everyone was afraid to wear pants. She wore the suits, and that was where I was coming from. That's the kind of girl I related to. I liked the girl who had a natural hair, and she got in a convertible, and to me that was America, and it was the freedom, and I liked that kind of girl. And so
that Ricky came into your life as that golden girl, right?
That was the girl. She was beautiful. And she was natural, and she had all the right elements that inspired me. So I, you know, was inspired by her. She's my wife. You know, I'm living with a woman, living with a family. And, you know, I could feel where the world was needing things. She was not a prima donna who didn't work. She was a hardworking woman who went to school, went to college, went to, you know, study different courses, and she wanted to make her statement. So I was growing up at that time, and America was, I was saying, everything is coming from Europe. People are just looking at Europe, but they're not responding to what they have at home. And I was responding to the country and the world, and I was inspired again by the people in it, and the preppy sensibility of going to Harvard and Yale, the kind of things that were very important to people that were growing up and going to school, and what inspired them. And so there was American heritage that I fell in love with. It wasn't because I was planning to do it, it's what came out of me. I was inspired by things that were in America that were not looked at. They were not fashion, and I was never about fashion. I was about living.
Living.
And I saw living in a home and living with children and beautiful white houses with picket fences and green shutters and things that were very America. And I said, you know, there's inspiration here.
打造时尚帝国，如何融合流行文化与娱乐？
I want to be a movie star.
呈现品牌故事的方式与制作电影又有何异同？
It seems that you are presenting real people, not just models.
And I need that to build my story. I need the story.
请继续收看杨澜专访美国时装设计师拉尔夫·劳伦，敬请关注。
这里记录的是一个人和他的时代。
1946年，中国第一位原子物理女硕士王光美放弃去美国读博士的机会，离开北平奔赴延安，第一次见到了刘少奇。此时季羡林刚刚从德国回到北平，成为北京大学教授，继续潜心研究梵文和吐火罗文。1982年，季羡林回到母校济南一中参加校友聚会，不远处的济南二中，17岁的巩俐最大的心愿是能考上一所师范学校。2006年，巩俐来到英国参加电影《迈阿密风云》的首映。不远处的克劳伦斯宫里，58岁的查尔斯正和卡米拉庆祝他们结婚一周年。此时，泳池里的菲尔普斯正备战北京奥运。在水立方，他一人夺得8枚金牌的传奇将令世界为之惊叹。21世纪的第一个十年，杨澜访谈录走进这些历史风云人物，以独特视角为您讲述一个人和他的时代。1994年，曾有一部美剧风靡大街小巷，那就是《老友记》。 这部播出时间长达10年的电视剧也伴随了无数中国观众的成长。拉尔夫劳伦在该剧中以其真实身份客串自己，他的公司在剧中为女主角 Rachel 自力更生开创事业提供了舞台，而劳伦本人偶尔的露面则大大提高了自己品牌的认知度。
We checked with some of our audience and they said they were first aware of Ralph Lauren's brand by watching the sitcom Friends.
Oh, yeah.
Because one of the characters was supposed to work for you.
Yes.
Yeah. And so the kind of the combination with pop culture, entertainment, was a big brand building for you.
Well, I want to be a movie star. You know, I think...
What kind of movie star did you want to be?
Cary Grant.
Uh-huh.
Steve McQueen.
Okay.
Paul Newman. Mm. Those are people I... But, you know, I don't think... Woody Allen. Mm. He writes, directs, dreams up the whole story and has his own. He was very inspiring to me. He's a friend of mine.
So you like those more sophisticated characters?
No, I like fun. I like them all, you know, but I think they're all parts of life and all parts to play. As I do this clothes, I'm taking different parts of the life and making them real and making you understand why I did all those colors or why I did black. Or so it's they come together as a story. And in terms of acting, I'm the actor, I'm the star, you know. That's how I do my men's clothes. And we put them together, and the guy and the girl, and we make a movie in our world. And I, on some levels, could never be the movie director or things like that, but I love that part of the world. I love making that contribution so that consumer gets the story, they get the mood, they get the dream.
Well, and also I'm interested in the way that you presented the story of your brand. It was like making a movie. Did you have a script for those shoots, the photos? When you projected those designs, it seems that you were presenting real people, not just the models.
That's how I design. You know, some people say, well, I'm just going to do the red dress and make that beautiful. Mm. I like the story because it keeps me into the world. And so in making that movie, what kind of girl, what should her hair be? Mm. What kind of hair should she have for this clothes? What are the accessories, what works, what's the dream? And so when I finish a show, when someone comes up to me and says, I love that dress, that's not a compliment. Mm. When they say, I love your movie, mm. I love the whole show, that's it. I love the music, I love, because all of it is one, and that's how I see life also. Mm. It's not one story, it's not one happening. And people know that the best of all your times are the accidental times, mm. the things that you don't plan for, the things that you
just happen. As John Lennon said, life is what happens to you when you're planning other things.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Ralph Lauren 对于时尚界带来的最大的财富，就是他不是卖衣服的，他是在推销生活方式的。他也曾经这样说过，我们是生活方式的革新者。那么在他长达50多年的创业历程当中，遇到过怎样的一些刻骨铭心的挫折？是什么又让他在古稀之年依然孜孜不倦地奋战在充满竞争、人才辈出的时尚界的第一线呢？在下一集《杨澜访谈录》当中，我们继续走进他的时尚世界。下次见。
Tell us the story about dress for the Great Gatsby.The Robert Redford's version. That was the time that made your brand, as a cultural element.
Well, it was
not just fashion.
It was the inspiration I had long before Gatsby was the kind of clothes that I related to. So it was the pink suit and the white flannels and the glamour of the period. When they were doing the movie, it was amazing that I was selected to do the men's clothes. There was an overall fashion costumer, but I did all the men's clothes for The Great Gatsby. Robert Redford and all the people that I know. Buffy is a friend of Robert Redford's. I used to run with Redford in the park.